Okay, let us continue our lecture on sequences and series. What we learned so far? We learned about sequences. Now we moved on to series. Our goal is to analyze a series. Well, recall that we define a sequence by listing the terms of that sequence. You say that, hey, suppose you have a sequence f of n is equal to a sub n. So we list the terms of the sequence, a sub 1, comma, a sub 2, comma, a sub 3, and so on. What we do, we take the limit of this function. If the limit exists, if it's a unique number, we say that, hey, we have a convergent sequence. And that's it for us. There you go. Now we add the terms of a sequence and we create something new, which we call a series. By adding the terms of a sequence. By adding the terms, we introduce a new object, which we call a series. A sub 1 plus A sub 2 plus A sub 3 plus. Remember that here we say we use a Greek letter sigma to show that we have summation over the terms. A sub n, n starts from 1, goes to infinity. This is an infinite series. Our goal is to analyze a series. Okay, to analyze a series, we need to define something new that we call the partial sum definition. Perfect. Suppose we have a series. This series is denoted by the sum a sub n, n starts from 1, goes to infinity, and you all know that you need to add the terms of this series. A sub 1 plus a sub 2 plus a sub 3, a sub 4, and the rest. So that's how we define a series. The n partial sum of a series is defined this way. The n partial sum. So it means that we are adding some terms and we stop at the end term. It's denoted by the sum a sub I starts from 1 and it stops at n. The partial sum, the end partial sum. So it means that we have to stop at some term. What term? A sub n, the end term. So you have a sub 1 plus a sub 2 plus a sub 3 plus a sub 4 plus the rest of the terms, and we stop at a sub n. This is called the end partial sum. So now we're going to use the end partial sum to talk about the convergence and divergence of series with infinite terms. We say that if the sequence S sub n is a convergent sequence, is convergent, then its limit is equal to a number, a unique number like S. This is a number, a unique number. It's not infinity, it's just a fixed number, and it is unique. If the limit is equal to S, it means that if the sequence S sub n, this is S sub n, what is S sub n? S sub n is the nth partial sum, 1 to n, is convergent, then we say that our original series, infinite series, is convergent. And we say that the sum a n, n starts from 1 to infinity, is convergent. So this is a series, and then if you give different values to n, you define a sequence. For example, S sub 1 is equal to A sub 1. S sub 2 is A sub 1 plus A sub 2. So this is the first term of the series, and then you define it as a sequence by assigning numbers to these n values. So this is the first term of the sequence. This is the second term of the sequence. By adding them together, you get the nth partial sum, S sub 3, A sub 1, A sub 2, A sub 3, and S sub n is A sub 1, A sub 2, dot, 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 A sub n. So this is your sequence, the nth term of the sequence. The nth term of the sequence. Here we go. Very well. We're going to define a geometric series. Geometric series is important for us. Why is that? Because we're going to eventually use geometric series and some other series to help us analyze more complicated series. So, geometric series. A geometric series is defined this way. It's defined as, so your first term is A, the second term is AR, the third term is AR squared, AR cubed, plus the rest of the terms. This series can be written this way. The summation A R raised to n minus 1 and starts from 1 goes to infinity. If R is less than, if R is less than 1 and greater than negative 1, or if absolute value of R is less than 1, you say that, hey, this series is a convergent series. And the sum of this series is A divided by 1 minus R. We can prove this theorem using induction. By induction, we can prove this. So again, absolute value of R must be less than 1. If it's greater than or equals to 1, it's going to be a divergent sum. Okay, let's take a look at one example. How do we use this nice formula to help us analyze behavior of different series? So let me write down this formula here. Geometric series So if you have a plus ar plus ar squared plus the rest of the terms, which can be written as a r to n minus 1 and starts from 1 to infinity, the sum is a divided by 1 minus r. So again, we're going to use this series to analyze other series. Example. So what is the sum of the following series? What do we have here? We have 5 minus 10 divided by 3 plus 20 divided by 9 minus the next term 40 over 27 plus the rest of the terms. Okay, perfect. Well, I'm trying to create a series. I need to have addends. So this is my first term. I'm going to copy it down here. Plus minus 1, 10 over 3, plus 20 over 9, plus negative 1, 40 over 27, plus the rest of the terms. Now, let's compare this with a geometric series. The first term is a, the second term is a times r. It seems like my first term is 5. So this is 5 plus negative 1, 2 thirds times 5. Because my 10 can be written as 2 times 5. So I'm going to copy this down here. The same here for 20. 20 is 4 times 5. So it's going to be plus 4 over 9 times 5. So as you can see, I'm trying to create a and separate it from different powers of r. Here I have plus negative 1, 8 over 27 times 5. Okay, perfect. So far, so good. So far, everything is clear. Now, let us move on to form r. What is r? The second term is a times r. So r is negative 1 times 2 thirds. So I have 5 plus 5 times negative 2 thirds plus 5 times negative 2 thirds to the power 2 plus 5 times negative 2 thirds to the power 3 plus the rest of them. Very well. Okay, as you can see, you can use the geometric series formula. This is the sum of 5 negative 2 thirds to the power n minus 1 and starts from 1 to infinity, and my r is negative 2 thirds. Absolute value of r negative 2 thirds is 2 thirds, which is less than 1. It means that, so let me write down the condition here for you. It means that the sum is equal to a, which is 5, divided by 1 minus negative 2 thirds. And here I get 15 divided by, okay, this is equal to 3. So this series approaches to, this example says, what is the sum? If it's convergent, if it's divergent, what is the sum? So is this series convergent, divergent? If it's convergent, we always try to find the sum. So let's take a look at this series. Series that we have is 2 to 2n, 3 to 1 minus n, and starts from 1 and goes to infinity. Very well. As you can see, you have some powers. We have a power here, but it's just associated to one value r. Here you have two bases. One of them is two, the other one is three. Let us make some adjustments. So 2 raised to 2n and 3 raised to 1 minus n. My goal is to create n minus 1 as the exponent. So this is 4 to the n. And this is 3 divided by 3 to the n. Okay? Here you can say that, well, this can be written as 4 thirds to the n times 3. And since I need exponent n minus 1, I can add and subtract 1, and I can write it this way. This is equal to 3, 4 thirds to the power n. I add and subtract 1 to create n minus 1. Okay, here we go. This is equal to 3, 4 thirds to n minus 1 times 4 thirds. You can cancel out 3 and 3. You get 4 times 4 thirds to the power n minus 1. So this series, n starts from 1 to infinity, is nothing but a series 4 times 4 thirds to n minus 1, n starts from 1, goes to infinity. A is 4 and r is 4 thirds. Well, r is 4 thirds. R is greater than 1. So you can write since r is greater than 1, it means that they have a divergent sequence. We have a divergent series, sorry, not sequence, series.
Next example.
In this example, we have a decimal number. The example says, write the number, write the number. 2.317 is repeated, which is 2.3, 17, 17, 17, so 17 is repeated as a ratio of integers. Okay, ratio of integers. Let's see what do we have here. So let us break down the numbers. You have 2.3 plus 17. This is 0.0017 plus 0.00017 plus the rest of them. So if I add these decimals, I get this decimal number here. So what is this? I have 2.3 plus 17 divided by 10 to the third, plus 17 divided by 10 to the fifth, plus the rest of the terms. Okay, perfect. Ignore the first term. This term doesn't fit into the pattern. Keep this number as it is. This is just a number. Keep this. Now find a pattern using the rest of the terms. What's the pattern here? Okay. This is your A. This is A times R plus the rest of them. So this can be written as 2.3 plus A plus AR plus AR squared plus the rest of the times. This is 2.3 plus your A is 17 divided by 10 to the third, and your R is going to be just 1 over 100. So this is 17 over 10 to the third plus 17, 10 to the third times 1 over 10 squared plus the rest of the terms. Okay, I have R and I know the sum. So this I can written as 2.3 plus 17 over 10 to the third divided by 1 minus R, which is 1 divided by 10 to the third. So 10 squared. So here I have 2.3 plus, so if I simplify this, I get 17 divided by 1,000 over 99 divided by 100. And if I do the addition, the final number, the final fraction is 1147 divided by 495. So this fraction is equivalent to this decimal number. Very good. This example says, find the sum of the following series. So this is the series, x to the n, n starts from 0 to infinity, and x is in between negative 1 and 1. Well, I have x to the n. Let us write some of the terms of this series. I get x to 0, x to the first, x squared, x to the third, plus the rest of the terms, which is 1 plus x squared, plus x cubed, plus the rest of the terms. So look at your geometric series. You have a plus AR plus AR squared plus AR cubed plus the rest of the terms. Well, A is equal to 1 and X is equal to R. So using geometric series, since R or X is bounded between negative 1 and 1, this sum is equal to A, which is 1, divided by 1 minus X. So depending on the value of x, the value of x, we get different values. If you have, for example, the sum of a half to the x to the n, x is a half. If you have the sum of, for example, 3 over 5 to the n, x is 3 over 5, and the rest of the series. So substituting the value for x gives you different series. Okay, and one last example. Our last example says, here you have the sum of 1 over n times n plus 1, n starts from 1, goes to infinity. Very well. When you have a series like this, we're getting back to math 1b and using partial fractions. First of all, what's the nth finite sum? N partial sum. The n partial sum S sub n is defined as the sum of 1 divided by I times I plus 1, I starts from 1 to n. If I write it in expanded form, it's going to be like this, 1 over 2 plus 1 over, if I plug in 2, I get 6, then if I plug in 3, I get 12, and so on. It doesn't give me anything useful. Okay, so what else I can do? Let us use the partial fraction. The partial fraction says, hey, you have 1 over I times I plus 1, which is A over I plus B over I plus 1. So it means that A times I plus 1 plus BI is equal to 1. What's the meaning of that? It means that A plus B is 0 and A is equal to 1. So it means that your B is equal to negative. So this sum can be written as S of N equals to the sum 1 over I minus 1 over I plus 1. I starts from 1 to N. Now let us write this in expanded form. Here I get 1 over 1 minus 1 over 2 plus 1 over 2 minus 1 over 3 plus 1 over 3 minus 1 over 4 plus the rest of the terms. And if I plug in n, I get 1 over n minus 1 over n plus 1. Okay, take a look at these terms. Negative a half, they're opposite of each other. Negative a third and third, they're opposite of each other. Negative four and the next term, they're opposite of each other. You have plus 1 over n, you can cancel it out with negative 1 over n, which is the previous term. So you're left with S of n is equal to 1 minus 1 over n plus 1. When you take the limit of Sn, while n goes to infinity, this is 1 minus 1 over infinity, or 0, so it is equal to 1. Since the limit of your partial sum is 1, you say that the limit of this series is also